The discovery of the double helical nature of DNA provided the third of three great revolutions in biology, each of which has centered on life's most baffling property, that of inheritance. The first occurred over 100 years ago, when Charles Darwin propounded the theory of evolution through natural selection. The second came around the turn of the century, with the rediscovery of the work of Gregor Mendel and the birth of the science of genetics. And the third came in 1953, when the discovery of the structure of DNA by Crick and Watson explained the gene's ability to store, express, and replicate their immense vocabulary of information. With this discovery, the great, almost transcendental mystery of the gene was seen to lie not in some new laws or principles of life, as many had expected and some had hoped, but firmly in the realm of chemistry and physics. The science of molecular biology, which came of age with the discovery of the double helix, was born some 10 years earlier, when the experiments of Oswald Avery at the Rockefeller Institute indicated that DNA, and not, as most biologists had believed, protein, was the material of the gene. It was an unexpected discovery and slow to win acceptance, even in the early 1950s, and even in such quarters as the Medical Research Council's Unit of Molecular Biology at the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge, where Francis Crick, a physicist turned biologist, was then working.
I wasn't so sure, I think, at that time as to whether DNA or protein was the genetic material. Of course, I knew about Avery's experiments, and they were very suggestive, but you could argue they weren't watertight. I knew Maurice Wilkins. I'd known him before I went to the Cavendish, and he was working on DNA, and I would go and talk to him, but I didn't actually myself work on it, mainly because at the Cavendish they were working on protein structure. So I learned about polypeptide chains and X-ray diffraction and things of that sort, and essentially continued to be interested in DNA rather than doing any experiments or calculations.
A young biologist who had long had an ambition to discover the nature of the gene, James Watson, was rather more sure about DNA.
Oh, I think I thought it probably was the genetic material. I had been working in Copenhagen on the fate of the DNA during bacterial virus reproduction. And probably even from the time I was in graduate school, it seemed a logical molecule to think about. The Avery experiment said that genetic specificity could be carried by DNA. You could interpret it in a variety of ways, but given your choice, I think you picked on DNA.
But although Watson had gone to Copenhagen to learn nucleic acid chemistry, the subject bored him. DNA itself didn't loom large again until he heard a talk by Maurice Wilkins in Naples, who showed some X-ray photographs obtained from crystalline DNA.
This was very exciting to me because when I'd been in graduate school, I'm sure already by then, I'd read about the original sort of 1938 work of Asbury on X-ray photographs, and this was obviously a big step forward. So it seemed like a pretty good thing to do was to do the X-ray work because it might actually tell you what the molecule was like. I mean, DNA was a word. It never meant anything as a molecule to me, and I knew it was composed of nucleotides, but again, except for an exam, I would have never learned what the formula was.
Maurice Wilkins had worked as a physicist on the atom bomb during the war and had turned in disgust at what he felt was the way science had been misapplied to biology. With an interest in the gene kindled by reading a little book called What is Life, in which the theoretical physicist Erwin Schrödinger had speculated that the gene consists of a three-dimensional arrangement of atoms, he found himself at the King's College London, using X-ray diffraction to study the structure of DNA.
One of the reasons I think we got better diffraction results than Asbury, one of the main reasons was that we had better DNA made by Signer in Switzerland. And this sort of shows a basic principle here in scientific advance, that one was very dependent on all the essential work which was done by chemists and biochemists. And the X-ray and model building work was a little sort of pinnacle put on top of this wide and essential base. We also, an important factor was that I think we had a feeling about how to treat the molecule right, that as Bernal had found with protein crystals, you needed to keep them in the aqueous environment. And we also sort of lined the molecules up, especially parallel in fibers. And I was in Naples, actually, because I wanted to get the DNA in real cells, in the chromosomes, in the sperm heads of various creatures out of the Bay of Naples. Because at that time, one had very little idea about whether the DNA which chemists produced bore any resemblance to the DNA in a chromosome in a cell. And in fact, the X-ray diffraction results gave good evidence that it did.
Impressed and excited as Watson was by Wilkins' work, attention in X-ray crystallography circles just then centered not on the structure of DNA, but on the structure of proteins. News was coming through to Europe that Linus Pauling at Caltech had solved the major structural feature of many proteins with his discovery of the folding of polypeptide chains into an alpha helix.
So I tried in the summer of 1937 to find a way of coiling the polypeptide chain which would account for the X-ray photographs which we had obtained and Asbury had obtained too and other people, and which also would be compatible with our knowledge about the dimensions of the atomic groupings in peptides. Well, I was unsuccessful in 1937. I still don't understand why I couldn't find the structure. Not until 1948 did I succeed. In the meantime, Professor Corey, Dr. Corey, came to Pasadena, and he and a number of other people, my graduate students, began work determining the structures of amino acids and simple peptides with great accuracy. It turned out that all of the ideas that I had had in 1937 were right. There was nothing new, no real surprises. And one day, when I was Eastman professor at Oxford in the spring of 1948, April 1948, I caught a cold. It was before the vitamin C days. I caught a cold, and after a day or two in bed reading science fiction and detective stories, I got tired of that, and I thought, why don't I discover the alpha helix? Or thought something like that. Why don't I try to see if I can find how polypeptide chains are folded in a way compatible with all the knowledge that we have about structural chemistry, and such that they can form hydrogen bonds to hold the parts of the molecule together. I took a piece of paper, much like this piece, and I drew on it a representation of an extended polypeptide chain with the distances approximately right and the angles right, except that one angle did not have the right value. I still have that original piece of paper, by the way. This is the bond angle at the alpha carbon atom that didn't have the right value. So I folded the paper. Actually, it took several trials. I folded it along several parallel lines through the successive alpha carbon atoms. And finally, I found a way, by folding the paper, I could make this bond angle have the value 110 degrees. And I finally found a way of folding such that when I put it together, there was a NHCO bond formed by each NH group and each CO group, a hydrogen bond which held the a helical structure together and had just the right dimensions. I found that this structure, which turned out, of course, to be the structure of hair and horn and fingernail and muscle, and also present in myoglobin and hemoglobin and other globular proteins, a structure named the alpha helix, had 3 6/10 residues per turn of the helix, a helical structure in which there are 3 6/10 residues per turn.
James Watson read about the alpha helix on his return from hearing Maurice Wilkins talk in Naples. Now he was determined to work at a laboratory where X-ray crystallography was being applied to biological molecules. That laboratory turned out to be the MRC unit at the Cavendish in Cambridge. Although the major focus of the laboratory's work was upon proteins, Watson and Crick, both with their interest in the nature of the gene, wondered together if Linus Pauling's model-building approach to the alpha helix could be applied to the structure of DNA.
Well, our first thoughts about building models started with the data of Asbury, the English crystallographer who did most of his work in the 30s. And he published a paper, or he published several papers. The one we used was one he published in a Society for Experimental Biology symposium in 1947 called Nucleic Acids. And it showed that the X-ray diagram from fibers of DNA were dominated by one very, very strong reflection at 3.4 angstroms. And that's just the thickness of a purine or pyrimidine base. So Asbury had the idea that a DNA molecule was a long linear molecule in which the bases were stacked on each other like piles of pennies. The other thing we used was the fact that Maurice Wilkins had told us from the sort of dimensions of the crystalline form that there was clearly more than one nucleic acid chain in the molecule. It was difficult to decide exactly how many because you had to measure the density accurately, and that wasn't that simple. But he thought there were between 2 and 3, and my recollection is that their preference was for 3. The other thing which we thought about was, well, since it crystallizes, it must be very regular. But it was sort of our tenet that the sequence of bases along the molecule were going to be irregular. And we thought they'd be irregular because that was what we thought conveyed the genetic information. People now think that was a great idea, but there was really no other idea you could have. It was as simple-minded as it could be, was that if nucleic acids conveyed information, it was by the sequence of the four bases. Now, if they crystallized, well, the bases being irregular, we thought, four different types, four different shapes, that meant the regular component of the molecule must come from the sugar phosphate backbone. And we thought, well, if there are several chains and they pack together regularly to form a crystal, then the sugar phosphate portion of the molecule would have to be in the center of the molecule. We, of course, couldn't go much further because we didn't have in our possession the crystalline X-ray photographs. They hadn't been published. And one way of getting more information is that Maurice kindly asked me, would I come and hear a talk which Rosalind Franklin was giving in London in November of 1951.
This experimental X-ray data on DNA from Asbury and Wilkins was all that Watson and Crick had available to them before Watson's visit to King's in November 1951. But there was also by that time a useful background of theory, a significant contribution coming from Crick himself.
Now the theoretical ideas really fell into two parts. One was the general idea of a helix. It had been suggested by Huggins as long ago as the early 40s that the natural configuration for a fibrous structure was a helix. And this is because fibrous structures normally consist of monomers joined together end to end. So you've got one here, one there, and one there, and so on, exactly repeating in their chemical formula. And it's a reasonable assumption that if you've got, think of three residues in a row, that the relationship between the first one and the second one will be the same as between the second one and the third one. And this, if you make this assumption, this necessarily leads you to a helix of some sort. You may get what mathematicians would call a degenerate helix, that's a straight line or a circle, but to a mathematician those are all helices. So that was very natural, it was common around the Cavendish, and the fact that Pauling had done the alpha helix and had got a successful example merely underlined the usefulness of this idea. So both at King's and in London and in Cambridge, we were thinking in terms of helices. More important was perhaps the second one, that because of the alpha helix, Cochrane, Vand and I had worked out the Fourier transform of a helical structure. Now the point of doing that really is very much related to the first point. If you have a helical structure going round in this sort of way, the actual repeat before it comes before it's gone all the way round may be very large and therefore give you a large unit cell with many atoms in it, and you'd have to do a rather elaborate calculation in order to calculate the Fourier transform, the wave analysis, let's say what you get in the X-ray diffraction pattern. But because it's really just one little bit repeated over and over again, looked at from a different direction, it wouldn't be surprising if there was a compact mathematical form of doing it. And it turns out, because it's cylindrical, that the natural mathematical form that you use is Bessel functions. And this can be explained quite simply. The easiest way to do the calculations is to start off first with a rather simple case, and that is the continuous helical wire of infinite length. And to fix ideas, let's take this distance here to be, say, 30 angstroms. So that will be the pitch of such a helix. Now the transform of that is rather easy, and one can see why, because if you look how the X-rays are going to be scattered, you're going to have planes here and planes here, and there's going to be a tendency to throw off the intensity in this direction, and also, of course, in the corresponding direction on the other side. And when you do the mathematics, that's how it comes out. The Bessel functions are such that you get J1, which has a maximum fairly near in, on the first layer line, J2 on the second layer line further out, J3 and so on, so that you tend to get intensities coming up at these first maxima, like this, and also, of course, on the corresponding side here, like this, and down here on the other side of the origin. So as you get across in the diffraction pattern. We next consider a case, which is one stage more complicated, in which we put atoms on the locus of this helix. We now remove the helix, but instead we put a single atom at regular intervals, like this. And again, just to fix ideas, let's take this distance here as 3 angstroms, and that will give us, therefore, 10 atoms in one repeat. If you look what happens if you project the electron density onto this line, you'll get a series of points coming up at a distance of 3 angstroms, and for this reason, you'll get a strong 3-angstrom reflection in this direction up here. So you would certainly expect there to be a strong reflection here on the 10th layer line, at reciprocal 3 angstroms, and the theory shows that you repeat this pattern up here and down here on the minus 10th layer line, so that you tend to get across like this, and going up like that. And the net result is, not only do you get across, but you have a big open space in the middle here. Now naturally, when you take a real structure, it's not just one atom in the asymmetric unit, there's a whole group of atoms, and sometimes the atoms will add up and sometimes they'll subtract. But since there's never anything here, you'll always get the gap here, and you tend to get the first maxima and not these subsidiary ones here, so you often get them coming up in a cross of this form.
Crick was to use the helical theory in an attempt to interpret the X-ray pattern that Watson had seen on his visit to King's. But, unfortunately, much of what Rosalind Franklin said at the meeting, and which he attempted to pass on to Crick during a visit they made to Oxford, was over Watson's head.
Part of the the difficulty was I really didn't understand the jargon. I wasn't a crystallographer. And she'd keep using some terms like unit cell or something like that. And I wasn't sure what it was meant. But I was sort of thinking already in terms of helices. And one of the things she said was that there were 10 molecules of water per unit cell. And I thought that meant one big repeat along the axis. And that was about the only thing I remember, I think. So when I got to Oxford, I told Francis there was only 10 molecules of water per repeating unit. And Francis immediately realized that, well, you didn't really have to worry about water in the structure because it was just one solid mass of nucleotides. And if there was no water, there was we were lucky because we wouldn't have to worry of how the water fitted in. We could just start packing things together. And so Francis, I remember being on the train, he had all these Bessel functions, which I didn't understand. But he kept saying that we could put three in something like that. And I was very excited because it seemed clear, given the fact that I told him there was no water, that the structure would fall out almost immediately, provided that we could find some clever way of putting the sugar phosphate backbones together. There was an obvious both problem, and what seemed also a good thing was that obviously you couldn't put negative charges together, so you had to have cations. And then it was a question of what was neutralizing the phosphate charges. Was it sodium or potassium, or could it be a divalent ion like magnesium, which might bridge between two phosphate groups and maybe hold them together? So we thought, well, if we're very clever, we'll learn how to pack phosphate groups together with their ions, and then that will be a clean and nice structure.
All of this was on the assumption, of course, that there was very little water there. And if there were, as Jim has explained, if there was very little water, you had to neutralize the negative phosphates with the positive sodiums. But what Jim made a mistake was that there weren't so many, a small number of molecules per unit cell. They were what's called per asymmetric unit, which is actually quite a lot of water molecules. I mean, every base pair had quite a number of water molecules, not merely half one. So we were totally on the wrong track. And when it came actually to building the models and putting on the sugar groups, we found it was very, very awkward. And however, we thought it was going to come out all right, and we invited the King's group to come down, Maurice Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin and their collaborators. And then, of course, it emerged quite quickly that the thing was a wet molecule and not a dry molecule, and our structure was wrong. And I don't know if you remember, Jim, what it looked like, but essentially the phosphates and the sugars were in the middle. There were, I think, three chains, and the things twined up in some sort of way. But I guess one was so embarrassed about it at the time that the details have been flushed from my memory.
After their first and abortive attempt to solve the structure of DNA by model building, James Watson and Francis Crick turned most of their attention during 1952 to other problems, largely at the insistence of Sir Lawrence Bragg, the director of the Medical Research Council's unit at the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge, where they worked. They even gave their jigs upon which the molecular components of their models were constructed to the team at King's College London. But Watson and Crick had not put DNA from their minds.
So I was thinking of helices all the time, and I remember we would see Maurice Wilkins occasionally, and one time was when we went to London for the Royal Society meeting, which Linus Pauling was prevented from coming. And I saw Maurice and asked him whether they'd built any models. That was about 4 months after we'd given them jigs, and he said no. And I said, maybe we should have the jigs back, that someone else in the lab would need them. I guess I was figuring maybe we'd want them.
But we didn't get them back until much later. Of course, the whole difference between their approach and ours was that they wanted to use Patterson interpretations using the X-ray data, whereas we were following Linus Pauling and putting our emphasis on model building. And I think that's why they showed resistance to model building. I think there was a section among the crystallographers who thought that solving things by model building wasn't
quite cricket. They wouldn't have said that, of course, because they were mostly American. But I think that was where the difference of emphasis lay.
One of the reasons why the King's Group did not launch enthusiastically into model building was the difficult relationship that existed between Maurice Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin.
Rosalind Franklin was brought into the DNA work because she was a professional and experienced X-ray diffractionist. I had practically zero experience in this rather specialized area. And looking back on it now, I think one can see very clearly that if you regard the structure-solving thing as a race, we weren't really in the race from the beginning. And the reason for this was that, unfortunately, Rosalind and myself, we didn't manage to work together. Now, this matter of Patterson's or model building. Now, Rosalind took what any good professional X-ray person would normally take. She chose the Patterson approach. Actually, I don't have much faith in it, but you see, she was not sort of in the molecular biology tradition which Francis and myself had grown up in, more the sort of Pauling approach. So far as I was concerned, I mean, all Pauling, model building and so on was the perfectly natural way to proceed. But this was one of the reasons why Rosalind and I think, fell out. We were brought up in different traditions, and it was difficult to mix the two.
Actually, the King's Group did do a little model building, but were put off by the feeling that they didn't know what general principles the model should incorporate. At Cambridge, too, Francis Crick became interested in a principle.
Of course, although we weren't working on the structure of DNA in the summer of 52, we were always thinking about it and turning it over in our minds. And a rather curious thing happened when a brilliant young theoretical chemist called John Griffith and I happened to go to a meeting, a talk by Tommy Gold, the cosmologist, on the perfect cosmological principle. And afterwards we went off to a pub and I said to John Griffith, well, what's the perfect biological principle? You know, just for the hell of it, as it were. And we decided it was replication. And I said, look, there must be some simple way of getting at this. Why can't there be an attraction of like with like by the bases stacking on top of each other, an adenine going on an adenine, a thymine going on a thymine, or something like this? And John Griffith sort of nodded his head and said he'd go away and work it out in quantum mechanical terms, see if there was such an attraction. I didn't know at the time, but he was thinking of complementary things rather than like going with like. And a little later than that, I met him in the tea queue at the Cavendish, and I asked him if he'd done the calculations, and he said yes, he had done some very rough calculations, and he thought that adenine would attract thymine, stacked this way, and that guanine would attract cytosine. And I said to him immediately, well, that's all we need, because you can go from one to the other, the sort of replication scheme we have today. It seemed to me transparent that was so. What I didn't spot at the time was that it had consequences for the composition of DNA. And this only
These consequences weren't to become apparent to Crick until a visit to Cambridge by Erwin Chargaff. Chargaff had made a study of the base composition of DNA and had come up with the rule that the amount of adenine always equals the amount of thymine, while guanine equaled cytosine.
I wasn't aware of Chargaff's rules when he said them, but the effect on me was quite electric, because I realized immediately that if you had the sort of scheme that John Griffiths was proposing, of adenine being paired with thymine and guanine being paired with cytosine, you should get Chargaff's rules. So I was very excited, but I didn't actually tell Chargaff, because it was, after all, something I was doing to John Griffiths. And then there's a sort of musical comedy effect where I forgot what the bases were and had to go to the library to check, and I went back to John Griffiths to find which bases he said, and lo and behold, it turned out that John Griffiths' idea fitted in with Chargaff's rules, you see. So this was very exciting, and we thought, aha. And we realized, I mean, what anyone who was familiar with the history of science ought to realize, that when you have one-to-one ratios, it means things go together. And how on earth nobody pointed out this simple fact in those years, I don't know.
It's interesting that at King's College in London, Maurice Wilkins was quite familiar with Chargaff's rules.
Because I knew Chargaff and was aware of his analyses, one-to-one ratios, and the whole thing is, in retrospect, it's easy enough to see that one-to-one ratios suggested that things were connected in pairs. But at the time, it was very different. The idea of deducing structural characteristics from analytical data is really quite a big and, in some cases, unjustifiable leap. But in my case, the penny dropped on this one really very late, and too late in relation to any of our model building.
During the summer of 1952, Watson and Crick were not paying a lot of attention to DNA. But all the time, there was the worrying prospect that Linus Pauling might be.
We always worried, of course, that maybe Linus Pauling would start thinking about it. I'd seen Linus at the Biochemical Congress and talk slightly, and he said he thought the molecule would be solved by study of simpler molecules, that is, first principles first, which slightly relieved me, because that certainly wasn't the way we were thinking about it. But then in December, we heard via his son Peter, who was then a student in the Cavendish, that his father had a structure for DNA. And that made us very, very curious. We knew he didn't have the data at King's, and we thought, well, the structure probably isn't right. And we ought to tell the people at King's that heard that Linus had the structure, what was in his paper. So I went down to London one day and brought a copy of the manuscript to Maurice Wilkins, and showed it to him and said that Francis and I didn't see how it could be right, but would he like to see it? So Maurice looked at it. Then he showed me some of the new data that had been accumulated at King's during this period. The new data was really terribly exciting, because Maurice showed me photographs which indicated that there were two types of X-ray diagrams of DNA. One, the what they called the A form, which was the form that Francis and I had tried to think about. That was the crystalline form, which had vast numbers of reflections. It was a rather complicated looking picture. But then the second form, which they called the B form, was just a perfect helix. There was a cross of reflections, which, and you could virtually see the Bessel functions coming up and down. So I said, Maurice, it had to be a helix. And he said, yes, he thought it was a helix. And so I was virtually hysterical, because I said, well, it's so simple that one should build models and quickly get the answer. And I went to the shop in the Cavendish and started them to build models of the bases. We'd never had models of the bases, but I thought this time we'll really have a go at it. And then I started asking Francis for advice all the time, and I was still thinking in terms of we had to put the phosphate in the center, and Francis was not at all convinced and said, well, why don't you try and build a backbone in which the phosphates are on the outside? And so while Francis was doing something else, I'd be in the room trying to arrange a backbone to see if you could have a molecule which would go around once every 34 angstroms, or whether you could go around faster or slower or something like that.
That Watson and Crick were even able to think along these lines was due to some additional information from the group at King's. In this report, Rosalind Franklin had set out the differences between the A and B forms of DNA. The B form showed a very strong reflection at 3.4 angstroms due to the stacked bases, and the structure repeated every 34 angstroms. But the key fact was that the crystallographic cell was monoclinic. This, plus the data on its density, suggested that the A form of DNA, and thus by inference the clearly helical B form, must consist of two rather than three chains. But to Francis Crick, the fact that the cell was monoclinic had another very important consequence.
It happened to be the same as the space group I've been working on for a hemoglobin with Perutz, and I knew the space group was what is called C2. And What was important about that space group is that it had dyad axes at the side. This would immediately suggest to anybody who'd seen that point that since the chain of the DNA is polar, of one DNA chain, that is to say, it goes phosphate, sugar, but the sugar points, as it were, in a certain direction. In order to have a dyad at the side, one chain must run up, another one must run down. So that was one important clue which we didn't have before, and was only suggested by the evidence, but it turned out, of course, it was right. Now, it's not immediately obvious what difference it makes whether the chains run in the same direction or in opposite directions. You could have imagined a structure in which the two chains ran in the same direction, and then they'd be related by a dyad parallel to the fiber axis, so that at any one level, one chain would be on one side of this dyad and the other chain would be on the other. If you have that arrangement, then the repeat, this distance here, corresponds to when a chain has gone halfway round, that is to a rotation of 180 degrees. Since there are 10 residues in a repeat, that would mean that if the chains ran in the same direction, you would have to build a model with 18 degrees rotation for each residue. On the other hand, if the two chains are running in opposite directions, you don't repeat till you've gone around 360 degrees. So you have to go, each residue has to move round 36 degrees. So when you come to model building, what the rules are, you have to stick the thing in some way like that. You have to go up 3.4, and you have a choice. Do you go around 18 degrees, as if the chains were parallel, or 36 degrees if the chains were anti-parallel? Well, it turns out, and this is where Jim had a lot of trouble, that you can't easily build it with its 18 degrees. Everything is too tight. But if you allow yourself 36 degrees, there's room. So there were all these reasons for thinking the two chains went in opposite directions, and that there were two chains, and it was that which was the basis of the model building.
At that stage, they still hadn't completed the metal models of the bases that we wanted, so I had cut out some little paper models of the bases, not very accurate, but enough so that I could put hydrogen atoms at different places and see where you might form bonds. And Francis said that I should certainly think about Chargaff and his rules that adenine equaled thymine and guanine equaled cytosine. And so the next morning, I don't know why I didn't do it right away, but I think we were sort of, it was a beautiful spring, but the next morning I came in and started playing with the models, and then I discovered that you could put adenine and thymine together in exactly the same way you could put guanine and cytosine together. And that was sort of the base pairs. And I was immensely excited. And Francis came in and I showed it, and Francis caught a point which I hadn't got at all, which was that there was a, you could flip-flop the base pairs over so that adenine could be on either of the two chains if you had an adenine and thymine pair. But that's a sort of crystallographic argument, so Francis might say really what the argument is.
Well, essentially the argument is very simple. If you've got a dyad this way, so that you've got two parallel chains, then the glycosidic bonds, which go from the sugar to the base, must be parallel. If you've got dyads at the side, the two glycosidic bonds must form the base of an isosceles triangle, like this. And when I looked at what Jim had done, lo and behold, there, though he hadn't put it in, there was this isosceles triangle. In other words, something had come out in the base pairing, which of course fitted Chargaff's rules, which he hadn't put in. And it was from that moment, I think, we knew that we had it. Well, from then, of course, the next step was we had to build a model with the coordinates to show that it was acceptable, incorporating all the ideas, the phosphates on the outside, the base pairs and so forth, and that's what we proceeded to do. The reason we had to do model building was that although we had the basic idea of the structure now, namely that the phosphates were on the outside and we had to put in base pairing and so on, we still had to show that we could build a model with acceptable coordinates. When you build a model to see if it's going to be acceptable, you don't build something like that. That's quite unnecessary. All that's necessary to build is one residue, one bit, because if you get that right and you've got its relation to the next bit right, as it were, you can just imagine the rest of the model, or mathematics will generate it. We didn't even use a base pair. We just used this much here, That's to say half. Because I worked out a theorem, there has to be the diad axis here. I worked out a theorem such that you, as you move things around, there was a constraint. And if you built this half right, then this half would automatically come right as well. So the amount we built was just one residue, but you had to have one atom repeating, say like this phosphate. So you had a phosphate, a sugar, and one base, and you had to make sure that the relationship between this phosphate and this phosphate was what you wanted. That's to say, up 3.4 angstroms and round the 36 degrees. The aim we had was not to get the atoms in the right place, but to show that at least one version of the model could be built. Now, meanwhile, in King's, Rosalind Franklin, who earlier, for technical reasons, which Jim and I didn't believe and told her were wrong or misleading, had said it wasn't a helix, had come round to the view that it really was now a helix. But they didn't do any serious model building. They were using Patterson vector methods, and she actually was able to get the general features of a structure, namely the bases were somewhere like this, and that the phosphate sugar backbone was here, and she had a reasonable figure for the radius of the phosphates, which we didn't have. So, as it were, the two lines were converging at the time that we got the structure, but they did not have the idea of the pairing of the bases. That was what was missing. But, of course, they had very much better data. I myself had never seen this famous B picture, which Jim had seen. I saw it afterwards. And then they had the A form, which had very much more information on it. So in the upshot, there were three papers published, two from the London lab describing the X-ray data and then interpretation in general terms, and Jim and I published our paper giving the details of the model.
Linus Pauling first heard of the double helix when Crick sent him a copy of the manuscript of that paper. At first, Pauling was sceptical. There were several points about the model, for instance, that the chains run in opposite directions, that he didn't like.
It took me several months to reach the conclusion that the structure was right. And now I think, of course, there's no doubt about it. The code has been worked out. Many details of the genetic process are understood. First, it has led to a tremendous amount of scientific work. A great number of biologists are now DNA biologists working in this field. And of course, there are many people who are not DNA biologists who are carrying on studies in the field of biology and medicine that have been stimulated by the discovery of the structure of the gene. But it has another importance also, and this is in giving people who understand what has happened a feeling of understanding of the biological world, of the nature of life.
Francis, do you think we were lucky to have solved it? Or was it real brain work?
Well, I guess we were certainly lucky. And, of course, you give the impression, Jim, we didn't really do too much thinking. But we were lucky, I think, for two reasons. We were thinking about the problem at the right time. And then the two of us, by collaborating, when one of us got on the wrong track, the other one could get us out of it. When if I thought there were three chains at one stage, you were sure there were two. If you thought that the phosphates had to be in the middle, then I would be the devil's advocate and say put them on the outside. And I think this is very important in solving structures of this kind, because the difficulty is that you've got to give several logical steps one after the other. If you go wrong, you get one person gets too fond of their own ideas. I think another thing that which helped us in our collaboration was we weren't at least afraid of being very candid to each other, to the point of being rude. And if you don't have constant interchange and chatting together and saying what you think of the other people's ideas to their face, I don't think you can solve problems of this kind.
I've often had the thought in a slightly different way that if either of us, were either 2 years older or 2 years younger, at least in my case, I would have never solved it.
Yes,
I mean,
of course.
We had to be there just at that particular time.
Yeah, there is a myth, of course, that goes round, you know, that Jim was the biologist and he did the biological part and I was the crystallographer and I did the crystallographic part. And that just won't stand up to critical examination. Because the business of the one-to-one thing, meaning replication, was really the thing I spotted with John Griffiths. But the way the bases went together, which is really pure crystallography, which you might have thought I was done by Jim. And this is, I think, the importance of the collaboration. We sort of pooled the way we looked at things. We didn't leave it that Jim did the biology and I did the physics. We both did it together and switched roles and criticized each other. And this gave us a great advantage over the other people who were trying to solve it.